A very warm welcome to all my viewers to Sentinels Newsmakers. And my guest today is Miyanidhi Shira. She is the MLA from Ampathy in Meghalaya. Miyani, welcome to the Sentinels Newsmakers. It's wonderful to have you on the show this morning.
Thank you. Thank you for having me. It's great to be here with you.
Thank you so much. So, yeah. You know, you might be a first-time MLA in the Meghalaya Assembly, but you are not new to the world of politics. You have always seen your father there. You know, he's been the Chief Minister of Meghalaya, Mr. Mukul Sangma. So now tell me, how does it feel? You know, you now, yourself there in the Assembly, you know, holding those political rallies, meeting so many people. This is a very personal experience that you're going through after seeing your father do all of these things. So how does it feel?
I feel a great sense of responsibility and accountability now. So earlier, even though I was also somehow involved in politics, I could always pass the buck of responsibility, you know, to my father or my mother or someone else. But now that it has come on me, I feel a great sense of responsibility. And also, I feel so much love from my people who have elected me. So that love drives me to do more for them, you know. So
Yes, yes, of course, that sense of responsibility, yes. So let's hear about your views on this entire ILP issue, because, you know, it seems that the steam, once again, the pressure, once again, building up most of the student unions, like the Khasi Students Union, the Garo Students Union, they also several civil society organizations, they have already, you know, submitted a memorandum to the Conrad Sangma government, I guess just day before yesterday, asking them to speedily implement the entry exit points. So what are your views on this entire ILP issue? Because we've heard a lot of views, points, counterpoints, the positives and negatives of having something like ILP or something like, you know, very rigid entry-exit points. What are your views there?
See, ILP is an old act passed during the British, and it has its positives and its negatives. So also, it completely lies with the center, discretion of the center to give the ILP for the states. So that is why during our previous government, we had come up with a new act, a law, for which is called the Meghalaya Resident Safety and Security Act, which is similar to ILP, and which completely lies in the hands of the state government as to how to implement it. It is actually to help the tourists or outsiders coming in into the state, and it is the entry exit point is more like a facilitation center. However, we get to know who's coming in and for what purpose and all that, you know. So it is a new law which we can implement even without the center giving us a green light for ILP. So right now we are, as a state, I think we will be going ahead with that act, because ILP, we're not getting the ILP as of now, because we had already passed a resolution in the House, but till now we have not heard from the central government.
Yes, absolutely. Despite your chief minister, you know, meeting Amit Shah so many times. Yes, of course. So now the other issue that we all have been, you know, discussing these days is about the whole migrants issue because of COVID. Now, every state's economy has been bruised. Meghalaya is no different. Of course, the task force has been set up by the chief minister, Mr. Conrad Sangma. Several steps being taken, you know, deferring the salaries of the government employees, though that has been put on hold for now. Several steps there. But what do you think when it comes to the real issue of getting livelihoods and jobs for all those people? Because many thousands have come back to Meghalaya as well. And already, you know, your state, like all other states, has a huge number of youth who are educated but unemployed. So this new influx is simply adding up to that whole problem of unemployment and livelihood issue. So what, according to you, needs to be done? What would be your mantra to, you know, fix this problem?
Yeah, there's no shortcut to solving this issue. I think we will have a very difficult time in the coming days. And especially Meghalaya, you know, it's a small state. However, we are lucky in this way that we don't have so many migrants. We majority of the people who have come back in are students, but I think around 60% were students and 40% were migrant workers. So we don't have that many numbers as compared to other states who are working outside the state. So I think we have an opportunity to give them a platform in the state. I think we should look at it in a positive way. And most of these workers, if you look at it, if you look at the breakup, they're mostly involved in the tourism sector.
Right.
People who are working in the hospitality industry, or people who are working in factories or construction companies. So we have a lot of companies which are involved in construction or tourism. So we can easily promote these sectors and, you know, absorb all these workers into our own state. So I think if the government can, you know, actually look into these sectors and, you know, absorb all these workers, I think we will not have much of a problem there.
Right, right. But I'm sure you must have also, you know, applied your mind on how to fix the tourism and hospitality sector, because that is one of the sector that has been hugely hit in the past few months, obviously because of COVID and the lockdown. And I don't think it's going to, you know, turn around anytime soon, because of obvious reasons. I don't need to, you know, spell out everything, you know, our viewers know. So what do you think? How do you think, you know, these sectors can be fixed over a period of time?
Yeah. As you know, Meghalaya is heavily dependent on tourism. We're heavily dependent on tourism sector, on the mining sector, and agricultural sector. So 80% of the people are involved in agriculture. So these three sectors, I think most of our people are involved in. So tourism sector, we are looking at, even the even our Honorable Chief Minister, Mr. Conrad Sangma, was talking about how we can bring about tourism which is safe and which can be for the domestic tourists. And I would really encourage the government to, I think, once the borders are secure and once our people have already come in, I think we open up systematically, controlled, in a controlled manner, for our local tourists. You know, even the local tourists have a lot of spending power, especially during this time when they don't, they cannot go outside. You know, they would want to spend their income within the state. So I think we have a great opportunity here.
Right, right. So basically what you're saying is that developing a regional or within the state.
Within the state tourism, we can promote for the time being, and then after that, we can promote it more on the domestic level within the country. Yeah.
Yes, right. Do you think that, you know, having these entry-exit points might in any way hamper tourism and business coming into the state?
No, I don't think so. I don't think so. Because, for example, even if you have traveled outside in countries like Bhutan or New Zealand, for that matter, you'll see that in every airport or in every entry point, there is... a facilitation center wherein the tourists are helped, or the business, whoever goes for business or whatever, you know, whatever their purpose might be, they are given, they are met with brochures, and then you can enter your details and then you are helped, you know. So the idea of these entry exit points are mostly as facilitation centers. I think it will really help the local businesses that way.
Right. Right, right. So moving on to one of the, you know, very important issues that we have been discussing over the years now. And like you mentioned, your state heavily depends on that particular sector. Of course, it's the coal mining space. We cannot easily forget what had happened in that rat hole mining accident that took place in Kasan. What are your views on the whole coal mining issue?
See, the rat hole mining which was going on was not a sustainable one at all. And we have been trying to bring people into scientific mining. But as you know, it's a very difficult job. And people, once they are settled into something, to bring in something new is very difficult. Right. So same case with the scientific mining. The government tried to bring in, during our previous government, tried to bring it in, but people were very skeptical and very resistant at that point of time. And unfortunately, NGT had to step in and, you know, ban the whole rat mining thing, which has affected badly on the economy of the state. So now what the state needs to do is just work on the details of how to bring about scientific mining and bring in all the stakeholders together so that people understand the importance of scientific mining in the long run. And the problems that we are facing, the miners and other stakeholders are facing right now, is temporary. If if they want to do sustainable mining, then they have to work on their new mining plans and everything. So miners as well as all the other stakeholders have to understand that that is the priority.
Right. Now, Mr. Conrad Sangma, the Chief Minister, has been promising about, you know, alternate livelihoods. Of course, this is related to the whole mining issue, because when the rat hole mining accident happened, he really spoke about, you know, providing alternate livelihoods for the people so that people of the state do not have to get into such hazardous professions. Also, there was a huge thrust on entrepreneurship. So how successful do you think the Conrad Sangma government has been in these initiatives of theirs?
Not very successful as of now. They have tried, but it has not been very successful, I would say.
Right. Okay. Okay. So talking about your plans as the MLA, I'm sure you have a plan, a vision for your constituency and your state. Would request you to share your plans and vision for the state.
Yeah.
And the people.
Yeah. So my constituency is right in the corner most, so to say, in the southwest corner of Meghalaya. And my constituency is the district headquarter. So the district, it borders Assam as well as Bangladesh. So I think we have a lot of scope for trade. Maximum of the people are dependent on agriculture, and the soil is very fertile. So my plan is to bring about a socio-economic change in the people of my constituency, first of all, and of course to replicate it in the entire state. When I say socio-economic change, we are a tribal society, and we have a lot of practices, superstition, so to say, which should be done away with now in this modern age. So there are a lot of awareness, education, and changes that need to be brought about in our social, you know, everyday life. So it is a continuous effort from the legislators and then from all the leaders in the society. So I think that is a huge effort there. And economic change, of course, people are heavily dependent on agriculture in my constituency. So to bring about, you know, scientific methods so that they can increase their produces and, you know, so that we can give them a sustainable livelihood. So these are the basic ideas as of now. Mm-hmm. And also, I think healthcare and awareness is very important. And now, as you can see, with COVID, yes. I think basic hygiene, you know, basic hygiene. So, that. So I would overall say the socioeconomic changes.
Absolutely. Life. Yes. Yes. Life. And yeah. And wish you all the best with you know, all the plan that you have of bringing about so many changes. Because like you said, you know, bringing about changes, mindset changes as far as certain superstitions and beliefs are concerned, that's really going to be a tough one for you, because you and I both know how difficult, you know, because that's going to be really a tough one. And like you said, while we were speaking earlier about the whole mining issue, to bring in any kind of change, to bring in any kind of new thing into the system, it's pretty much tough. So really wish you all the luck. And we really look forward to a better, new Meghalaya under people like all of you, the young generation of politicians, the Gen Next. So, now, would like to also, you know, prick your thoughts on this other issue about overall health infrastructure. You mentioned that because of the COVID thing, a lot of issues did come up. We saw how poor our health infrastructure is, not just in Meghalaya, whole of Northeast and whole of the country. So any suggestions from your side, your views, or maybe something that you really thought, this is how it should have been done. Like many people say that the public expenditure should significantly go up, and that has not been happening, not just from the state's side, but even from the central government side over the years. Yes, so anything like that, anything specific that you have thought about?
See, our overall health sector is it's in a bad shape. I'll stick to Meghalaya as of now. Meghalaya had very less civil hospitals as well. Now it has just been upgraded just in our previous government. I think a number of civil hospitals came in. However, these civil hospitals need upgradation. Like, it does not, in my district we have one civil hospital which does not have an ICU. Does not have a proper ICU, and therefore critical illnesses cannot be treated there. So they have to be brought in to Shillong or Tura or sent to Guwahati or Assam, wherever. So therefore, one thing which I would like to urge the government is to upgrade these hospitals, because cities like Shillong and smaller towns like Tura cannot bear the burden of healthcare of all the other districts. Now, if the other districts are also equipped with basic ICUs and basic facilities, then they would not have to go to all the other cities or towns. So, basic upgradation, like ICUs, that is number one. Number two is it is very difficult to get specialists. I think I am glad that I have raised all these questions in the assembly in the past 2 years. So basic structure of the healthcare system needs to be changed. Like, for example, if I'm a basic MBBS doctor, if I have joined the government earlier, and if a specialist comes in, he is the junior of an MBBS doctor. So basic small things like that need to be changed in the future, so that it is more attractive for the specialist to come in and join the government to serve the people. Otherwise, in this present scenario, I don't think once you study so much and then you become a specialist, and then they wouldn't want to be a junior doctor. I don't think so. So, you know, certain small things need to be tweaked here and there. So simple things like that, I think in the long run will make a lot of difference.
Right. And finally, you're a young politician belonging to the Congress camp. We all know what is the plight of that grand old party at this point of time. So as a young politician from the Congress party, what do you think is the future of this grand old party? Where do you see Congress going from here?
I think... everywhere we have ups and downs, and I think same goes for the grand old party, for our Congress party. We're having a bad time, so to say, but it is a time for rebuilding. So there is a future, but we need to introspect and we need to work harder. I think honestly, I feel that Congress lost touch with the ground realities in the center. So that way, I think we need a bridge between the ground realities and the people leading there in the center or in the central leadership. However, we are working towards it and we're building up the party as of now, and I think we are slowly regaining. We are slowly regaining, and I'm sure that in the future we will come back.
Okay. And as far as Meghalaya Congress is concerned, what are your plans? How are you, you know, building up the party there in your state?
Well, I think the party is still strong, very strong in Meghalaya, and we have, of course, we lost the last election, but that's just with a couple of, you know, seats. So we have not lost much ground. It's, you know, politics is like gambling at times. You know, it depends on luck as well. And maybe it was a good time for us to, you know, look into ourselves, introspect, and then make ourselves stronger. And yeah, I think it was a good change for people as well to see. Obviously, we've been in power for so long in Meghalaya. So I think, yeah, we can do better in the future.
Absolutely. So all the best for all your plans and your political career. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Thank you. And looking forward to more such interactions with you. Pleasure. Mm-hmm. Thank you once
thank
again.
Thank you. Yes, it was a pleasure talking to you, Anitam. Thank you.
Thank you so much. Yeah. And thank you, viewers, for watching. Thank you and goodbye. Thanks.